much for taking the time to speak to us, Sam, on the Alternative Cinema Show. Harvey, when you speak to studio executives, they tell you that they cannot make a profit or survive without blockbusters movies. Mm-hmm. Yet, you keep making those modest budget dramas, mm-hmm. and you're still flourishing. Mm-hmm. How does that work for you?
It's either a tremendous amount of luck, which I'm beginning, as I get older, more and more to believe, or it's just, you know, we believe that don't underestimate the movie-going audience, because they will constantly nourish and surprise you. So if you're, you know, if you have the courage of your convictions, I think you can have success too. But you really have to believe, and you have to fight harder.
But you don't just pick any drama. You pick things that are quite risky. I'll just give you an example, The Artist.
Right.
No one in Hollywood would ever contemplate taking a black and white movie, silent movie, and turn it into this massive success.
Well, you know, The Artist, not only were the people in Hollywood surprised, but the people in my own company were shocked, Sam. You know, I went and I said, guys, we're gonna do this black and white movie. They said, okay, black and white, he's a little crazy, but you know, he won last year for the King's Speech, so we'll indulge him. And then they said, it's gonna be Jean Desjardins, and they go, who's that? Whatever, and then I hit him with the boomer. I said, and by the way, it's a silent movie. And they went, you're crazy. I had to go to the board of directors. I had to get it approved. But anyhow, I believed in it. I thought it was an amazing movie. I thought it was so artistic and so beautifully done and wrought that you had to believe in it. And you know, you have to, you know, we started in Cannes, and then we went to Telluride, and then Toronto, and then every festival in the country, and then the Golden Globes and the Oscars and the whole, I mean, it was just an incredible effort, you know, to make that work. And I'm so proud of the film.
How do you convince people of something that seems so impossible?
You know, you do it with awards. You do it with winning festivals. I mean, you know, it's a lot of hard work. It's, you know, I mean, by the time you get to the movie in the theater, you've already sort of pre-sold it, Sam.
Why awards are so important? And are they your path of making these successful movies and get them out there?
The movies will not succeed unless we have the acclaim. That's why the award season becomes more and more important.
There's something else you do which is really bold and courageous. You take movies that are highly controversial and with political and social overtone. You did that several times. Mm-hmm. And sometimes I get the feeling that you do it because you have political convictions. Mm-hmm. And all of them, they reflect your own political convictions. Mm-hmm. Well, you've done this with Citizen Four, now mm-hmm. you're releasing. Is cinema for you is a platform to also promote your own convictions, political or social, not merely entertainment?
I'd be lying to you if I said no, you know, and I'd be giving you a political answer if I said no. But I try to be extremely careful. First of all, Citizen Four is the work of Tom Quinn and Jason Janego at Radius, which is a company we're partners with them on. And honestly, and I
just to explain, Citizen Four is about Edward Snowden.
Citizen Four is about Edward Snowden. And you know, when I, you know, I'm close to the president. That's not a secret. And you know, it's hard for me, you know, to be involved in a movie. And I tell the guys I don't want to see it until the day before you're releasing it, so I can't do anything about it. You know, I don't want to be involved, you know what I mean? And then I saw it, and I was very moved by the film. And I had to say that my impression of Snowden, who I thought was irresponsible when I first, you know, read what he did and saw it on television, when I saw this intimate look at who he was, I changed my mind, you know, and I went against, you know, my friends. And I think for the right reasons. I want to hold a mirror up. I'm not saying I know what's right or I know how to do it. I'm not, you know, I know nothing like that. But I do know that when, you know, we do Fed Up or Bully or these kind of things, they resonate with audiences. People discuss it. They become part of the conscientiousness.
This is, I've seen you've done even more than that. I recall a movie you made, Miral, about the Israeli-Palestinian conflict from a Palestinian perspective, which is unheard of. When you take these projects, do you really think of money? Because the chances of making money of these movies sometimes you take on it's quite slim.
No, I never do. You know, I mean, look, we've been lucky enough to have movies that have worked, that are intelligent. Thank God there's an award season because they help us with those movies, and they turn the King's Speech from a little art house movie into a blockbuster, which we need. But you know, it's not like we take the money and run. We invested in the morale. You know, I think it was very important to tell the story of the conflict from the point of view of Palestinians. And when I met Rula, you mean whatever, I said, this incredibly intelligent, beautiful woman who's a newscaster, you know, her story needs to be told, and the story of how they started that school, you know what I mean, and what that school has done for these kids, you know, needed to be told too. So it's, you know, I have many Israeli friends, I'm Jewish, you know, they disagreed with the whole idea of the movie, and you know what, in that case, I'm gonna say unequivocally, not telling that story from a Palestinian point of view is wrong, and they were wrong to try to suppress that, and they will never get me to suppress that. I'm proud of that movie, and I'm proud of Rula and Julian Schnabel for telling it so well.
Everybody agrees that without your immense contribution, cinema would be very different today, and of course, thanks to you, we have a crop of great directors, icons now, like Quentin Tarantino and David O. Russell, Steven Soderbergh. But you're also known for impinging on your director's vision sometimes.
Not those three.
Of course not those
three. They're dangerous. Only the ones who don't carry arms.
So why do you feel that it's necessary to do that sometimes?
First of all, it's exaggerated. You know, I said recently at the Producers Guild, I said the reason they called it Harvey Scissorhands was competition when I first started. You know, and I said, competition that does the same thing. Studios do it all the time. You know, I mean, it's not like we're impinging, you know what I mean, at Weinstein Company. I don't know what studios do. I think they do more impinging, but they just do it more
secretly.
But
you're different than the studios. Studios, they don't make independent cinema. They make big products.
And they shape their product, you know, accordingly.
But you work with auteurs.
Yes, but just because they're auteurs doesn't mean, you know, that, you know, I mean, they shouldn't be conscientious of audience and critics. You know, I mean, when you deliver a cut that's 3 hours and 30 minutes of a movie that should be 2 hours and 30 minutes, you know, it's just, you know, sometimes it's helping them get clear. Look, when I'm inside a movie myself, I'm blinded by it. You know what I mean? So I can't even see my way out of things sometimes. You just need an outside voice, whether it's me or the audience, you know, to tell you. So, you know, I think there's so much less of that, because what I've gotten all my directors to do now is just put it in front of an audience. I don't even have to say anything. The audience speaks to them. You know, the audience really talks to them.
Harvey, thank you very much.
Thank you, Sam. Thank you.